But this is the season that chapter number 6, drop down to verse number 45. If you want it, you'll find these words here. Just two verses, and then we'll go and see what thus saith the Lord. Dr. Frazier, thank you for those early morning prayers. Since I got the mic, I would be on the sometime. I preach those prayers. Ain't no need you sitting up here and trying to figure out what the Lord said. He just spoke. Yeah, it's good to get your wing and a biscuit and go to bed. He spoke right on Facebook through prayer. Amen. Second Mark chapter number 6, look at verse number 45, and I'll be out of your way in just a few minutes. And it says, and straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side before unto Bethsaida, while he sent away the people. Alrighty? He told them to get in the ship, alrighty, and move to what's next. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. And when evening was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. And the word of the Lord is blessed. Look at somebody tell them, you had to go through what you went through. Just to get to the other side. Just to get to the other side. You had to go through. You had to go through what you went through. Just to get through the other side. Let me say this in my closing here. Please understand that life can be understood backwards. But it must be lived going forward. It is easy to look back with the mindset of woulda, shoulda, and coulda. But the truth of the matter is that the windshield is larger than the rearview mirror. And so everything that God has for you is not behind you, but it's before you. Yes, I'm telling you, you got to move forward. We all will one day look back, but before we can look back, we must be willing to go forward. Willing to move forward and move. When it talks about the children of Israel after coming out of Egypt, the Bible says that they were trapped at the Red Sea, and when they began to look back, they saw Pharaoh on their heels and the Red Sea before them. They begin to say unto Moses, Moses, why have you brought us out here? It would have been better for us had we been down in Egypt. At least we would have had graves to die in. And Moses began to talk unto God, and God began to say unto Moses, tell the children of Israel to go forward. Let me say, I tell them, go forward. Go forward. See, living forward, and I want you to get this here, is not about your destiny. Going forward is not about your destiny. Can you hear me? Going forward is more about your journey. I said to my son when I dropped him off at school the other day, I said, son, keep in mind that there are children who are coming to this school who have come by plane. There are those who have come by bus. There are those who have come by automobile. But it doesn't matter how you got here. The main thing is that you made it. Yes, and I tell them, I can't tell you everything. Because truth of the matter is, I don't even look like what God has brought me out of. But what I can tell you is that through some ups and some downs, through some hardships, but thanks be to God, I made it. See, you may not be able to discern this, but some of the people on your road is not dancing and shouting about where they're going. They're dancing and shouting about where God has brought them from. The saints of old used to sing a song, look where the Lord has brought me. And other old folks would sing it here. They would say, brought me out of darkness into a marvelous light. Look where the Lord has brought me from. And then they would grab hold to it and say, brought me from a mile.
Yes, sir.
I ain't getting no help. Look at somebody tell me, you might be too young for that. God has brought me from a mile. A long way. responsive for turning the turn. Please understand that your journey is the distance to your destination. Your journey is designed to develop your commitment. Your journey is designed to discipline your character. Your journey is designed to validate you. It's in your journey. It's nothing worse than hearing somebody stand up and tell you what God can do when they ain't never experienced God doing nothing. Look, that's the kind of trouble. Never let a naked man sell you clothes. Stop trying to tell me what God can do and tell me what God did for you. I got Bible for it. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. Oh my God. Look, that's what I'm talking about. I got a testimony how God can take nothing and do more with nothing than a whole lot of food can with something. Anybody got a testimony that when you look at a person now, you see their polished presentation? But look at somebody telling them, baby, it wasn't always like that. You get them celebrating 46 years of marriage, but look at somebody telling them, it wasn't always like that. I had to go through some things just to get where I am, and now that I'm here, I might as well praise him. Because this is not my destination. This is just a part of my journey. You know, a lot of times people get so into the promise, you know, that they forget that every promise has a process. And sometimes when you start going through process, people who've never been through anything has the proclivity, the propensity to tell you that your process is punishing. You're going through, you didn't do nothing to deserve it. It's just a part of your problem. Right? You need Bible. That doesn't mean by the name of Job, he was upright. One that excused evil and did no help. But the Bible says that Job was tried by the enemy. It wasn't punishment, it was process. And I help somebody, look at somebody and tell them, don't get upset when God gives you a process, because after the process is over, you will come to that place called promise. And tell somebody, I'm just in the process. I'm just in the process. You remember, we see it. We were just talking. You remember when God gave Abraham a divine promise, gave Abraham a divine destiny. However, that destiny was not apart from the journey. The Bible says in Genesis 12:1, he began to demand. Somebody say, to demand, demand. He began to demand and say, Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house. It was a demand. Oh, yeah, we don't know what this is. It was a demand. But then after he gives him a demand, my God, he makes a decree. This is the decree. I will make of thee a great nation. This is the decree. I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. See, a lot of folk want to hear the preacher make a decree, but you can't handle his voice of demand. I ain't getting no help. See, when he tells you not to do something, you get upset, and all of a sudden you done heard from the Lord, and your season is up. But you saying, before I go make a decree over my life, I got a decree for you. Sit your hind parts down somewhere and learn how to take up the man. Commanded them into the promised land. And if you still stuck on encouragement,
Elijah, ask me for thy will. And he says, give me a double portion. He says, you can pass the hard thing. And he starts jumping and shouting and singing to the moon, my God. But you got to go back, my God, and come out of 2 Kings and go back to 1 Kings chapter number 19, where he found him plowing with 12 yoke of oxen. The Bible says that he discovered him. In other words, when it comes to your destination, you don't discover destiny. Destiny discovers you. I am here, Lord. Oh, my God, every time God, my God, Jesus put one of the disciples didn't run to him. He came to the disciples and saw them washing their necks and told them to follow him. I am here, Lord. I got a problem with people that always running up and want you to put papers on them and want you to anoint them and want you to push them forward. Elijah was pounding behind 12 yoke of oxen. Somebody say 12 yoke. One yoke of oxen is 2 oxen. 12 yoke is 24. And the Bible says he was pounding behind the 12 yoke of oxen for 7 praises here. And the oxen was kicking up dust and dropping dung. And I'm talking to somebody. He was walking behind the oxen that was kicking up dust and dropping dung when the prophet discovered him. Would you look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, when God look at somebody trying to stop granting people access to you that ain't never been through nothing with you. Stop letting people touch your garment that ain't never been through nothing with you. Lean over and tell somebody, do you understand what the move is all about? So it's something about that journey. Something. I'm a young man. I've just been preaching for a little while, and I've learned. My son asked me the other day, and that seed is there. I see God doing something in him. He asked me the other day, he says, Daddy, after all of these years of ministry, what have you come to the knowledge of? And I looked at him, you know, started wondering who we've been talking about.
Yeah.
He said, what do you mean? I said, the Bible says that Jesus took out a child and you said, unless ye become converted as this child, you can't even enter into the kingdom. He says, what do you mean? I said, did she have you depend on me and your mom for everything? He says, yes. I said, that's what maturity in God looks like. All right, that just went on some. See, maturity in God is not when you can stand in your independence. It's when you learn how to depend on God. Through it all, I will learn to trust in Jesus. Through it all, I will learn to trust in God. Through it all, I will learn to depend upon God. I ain't getting no help. Am I talking to somebody here? You know good and well, you ain't got enough to get it done. My God, it looked like you got more going out than you do coming in. And your testimony is that I will trust in the Lord until I die. I ain't getting no help right now. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm learning how to depend on him. I'm learning how to trust him. Because when you start depending on God and start trusting God, you have now developed on your journey for seven breakers here. You know you're depending on God when he lets you live with stuff other people died with. All right, I'll go somewhere else and tell a testimony. Look at somebody. You didn't take your medicine, but because you kept saying, God, you are my healer, you are my waymaker, you are my provider, you keep working in my favor. He didn't allow you to have no stroke, you didn't go to no diabetic coma, you didn't black out on the job and somebody found you in the alley. Look at somebody and tell them, I learned how to depend on the Lord. That's what the journey. When we could pay all the bills on one Sunday. I got 8 more minutes, I'm coming on now. I said, I remember we could pay all the bills on one Sunday. We just stand up. And it didn't work. You weren't even concerned about who was there and who wasn't there. Sent me in here to talk to you. I need you to make that available. God move. And so when we made this journey, and made this transition, and the other day they came and brought me when everything was done. I said, my God, this ain't enough to take care of half the stuff. You could hear the emotion in the voice. This ain't enough to take care of half the stuff. And my wife said, oh yeah, we trust in God now. I said, not right now, baby. He's getting ready to force you into a move. He's getting ready to force you out of that comfort zone into a place where you have no other alternative but to trust him. I need you to get out of your seat and find somebody and tell them you are not there yet, baby. He's getting ready to constrain you and put you in a place. I'll be there in a minute here to where now he loves you so much that you realize that you feel good in your journey, but this is not your destiny. Sometimes things are not working. feeling that where I am, I'm good enough. I got 55 members and that's all right for me. No, baby, the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, let them constrain you. He forced them into the ship. He said, get in. And he began to send them away. This is where the faith begins to become developed on the journey on their feelings. The Bible says that after he constrained them, he went up into the mountain and he began to pray. I just want to remind somebody right now that you might be doing good right now, but keep on understanding that even when you go through your storms, somebody is praying for you.
Not the season to not
your sword. Even if you tell somebody, I've got to open my mouth because the Lord is passing by this way. Thanks for the Lord, Mr. Savior. Pass me my mouth, oh, gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry.
Talk about it.
Because once they were rejected, but now they're tonight. And some of us have been rejected in places, and God said, get ready, you're about to be received. Once rejected it, I hear God saying, tell them to open their mouths and bless him, because you're getting ready to be received in the places, in the arenas that you were once rejected in. Look at somebody and tell them, get ready to be received. That place that the Bible says that, men stop them now. Men stop them, they came to that place. Speak softly. The wind stopped when they came to that place. And they got off. Yeah. And now they were received in the place that they were once rejected. Man of God, they never would have made it there had they stopped roaring with the wind. Had they given up and gone back when the wind came. I want you to understand something right now. You people of God, you're getting ready to make a move. You're getting ready to go through a journey. And the wind is going to come. But the wind that's coming against you is not greater than the wind that's in you. And the wind that's coming against you, God said, I'm going to rebuke that wind and give you the thrust that you need to make it to the other side. I want you to lift your hands right away.